In the last decade, solar energy has seen an average annual growth rate of over 40% globally. Still, as of 2019, just over 2% of global electricity came from solar. Why? Because the truth is, as great as they are, today's silicon panels are only so efficient. But that could all change thanks to an emerging material, perovskite. It's cheaper and greener than today's silicon panels, and may even increase solar efficiency by 50% or more. So how exactly will they work? And what sort of drawbacks might there be? Is this breakthrough near term, or like so much other tech in this area, the 5 to 10 years away? We thought these questions deserved a deeper dive today on Two Bit da Vinci. Special thanks to Roborock for sponsoring this video. Go from dreading to loving vacuuming with the Roborock H7. So what is perovskite and why is it generating such a buzz in the energy world? To answer that, let's first take a look at the current state of solar. While materials like copper, indium, gallium, selenide, it's a mouthful, and cadmium, tellurium have had their moments in the sun, the star in solar technology is crystalline silicon, which holds 95% of the market share. And for good reason. First off, it's the second most abundant material on Earth right after oxygen. Not only that, but its cells form a unique lattice structure that maximizes the potential to convert light into energy. Silicon solar panels are relatively inexpensive, mostly because they are so long-lasting. Many come with warranties up to 25 years, with the panels maintaining most of their efficiency well after that. But solar has a dirty side too. To reach the levels of purity required for use in solar panels, silicon requires immense amounts of heat, meaning immense amounts of energy. But where silicon is really running into trouble is efficiency. The best commercially available silicon panels run at about 22% efficiency, and the researchers believe that they're pretty much maxed out. Physicists William Shockley and Hans Joachim Kaiser calculated the theoretical maximum efficiency of silicon solar panels to be around 30%. These limitations, rooted in the materials, are holding solar back from further market proliferation. Enter perovskites. Perovskite is a calcium titanium oxide mineral and one of the most common crystal structures on the planet. Its incredible crystal shape shows up everywhere, but most of it's found buried in the Earth's mantle. While the material was discovered by German scientist Gustav Rose in 1839, it wasn't until over a century later that its benefits really proved to shine. Perovskite's unique crystalline structure is what has really begun to turn heads, not just for solar panels, but in other applications like superconductors and internet technology with data transfer speeds 1,000 times faster than current technology. In 2009, researchers began studying this material for next generation solar cells. And since then, they've generated quite a bit of hype. In just a few years, perovskite solar cells have not only matched, but began to outpace silicon cell efficiency. Having started at a humble 3.8% efficiency in 2009, by 2016, perovskite cells had reached a staggering 22.1%. As of October 2021, researchers from the US National Renewable Energy Laboratory certified UK startup Oxford PV achieved a landmark record with a panel that can convert 29.52% of incident solar energy into electricity. This is the third record for the technology set in 2021 alone. So what makes perovskite cells so much more efficient? Like traditional solar cells, perovskite cells are semiconductors. In this case, a layer of polycrystalline perovskite sandwiched between two electrodes, ground between electrical insulators like glass and metal conductors like copper. When light from the sun hits the electrons in the semiconductor material, they get excited, producing electron holes or excitons. Sounds like a rejected name for a transformer. These excitons flow into conducting electrodes, which produce an electric current. Before we get back to the show, let me tell you about our sponsor, the Roborock H7 vacuum. You might have noticed things look a little different. And well, that's because we've moved. For the past few weeks, our H7 has been in use constantly. It comes with the accessories for almost every cleaning job, like a baton for reach and a flex tube for versatility. Coupled with the multi-surface brush for floors, motorized mini brush for couches and mattresses, dusting brush for, well, dusting, and a crevice tool, there's nothing you can't clean. Its brilliant magnetic storage system makes it easy to keep track of the accessories while charging. The OLED screen shows me the cleaning speed and battery life. A full charge takes just 2.5 hours. The H7 has 3 cleaning speeds, and I mostly use Eco for the hard floors, giving me about 90 minutes of runtime, twice as long as my last vacuum. The 480 watts of extreme suction makes quick work of the most demanding cleaning jobs, like shag carpet and mattresses. Level up your cleaning game with the Roborock H7 vacuum today. Check out the links in the video description for special discounts exclusive to our viewers. Huge thanks to Roborock and all of you for supporting the show. One aspect that makes Perovskite more efficient is that it has a noticeably wider band gap. Basically, the range of possible energy values that an electron can have that can then allow it to leave a particular atom and become a free charge carrier. So the wider the band gap, the more these electrons will dissociate and the more electricity they will ultimately produce. An ideal band gap would be 1.4 electron volts, which would allow the material to absorb the maximum number of photons from solar radiation. Silicon has a band gap of 1.1 electron volts, which is better than the other materials, but still not ideal. Perovskite then? It has a band gap of 1.5 electron volts, making it even better than ideal. As a light-absorbing layer, Perovskite can take in a much broader range of solar energy, from visible light at around 380 nanometers to a near-infrared 800 nanometers. Silicon absorbs light between 500 and 700 nanometers. Perovskite's crystalline structure allows it to be tuned to different colors on the solar spectrum by changing the material composition, meaning you could tune perovskite materials to absorb light in one particular range, say ultraviolet light, while pairing it with either another material for another set of perovskites tuned to absorb light in another end of the spectrum. But wait, there's more. Studies from Cornell University suggest that perovskite solar cells may even have a smaller CO2 footprint than their silicon counterparts. The study, published in the July 2020 issue of Science Advances, compared the carbon footprints and energy payback periods of silicone, perovskite, and perovskite silicon tandem panels. The results showed that while silicon panels were nearly 20 times greener than natural gas and 40 times greener than coal, the perovskite panels were nearly twice as green as pure silicon, with the tandem panels faring the worst of the three. One major reason for the reduced emissions is that the perovskite requires roughly 78% less energy to manufacture than silicon, which uses up to 90% of the total production energy just to purify the silicon itself. On top of that, perovskite panels have an energy payback period averaging around 4 months, compared to silicon's 1.5 years. And these numbers will likely improve as the panels become more efficient. Manufacturing perovskite cells typically involves a low-temperature screen printing process that doesn't require a glass front. The process takes only about 30 minutes for the solution to bake and can pump out about 40 feet of solar thin film per minute, reducing the complexity compared to silicon panels. Best of all, this greener, faster process is significantly cheaper. One study by researchers at Nanyang Technological University in Singapore suggests perovskite cells could be up to 5 times cheaper than what they are currently on the market today. These cheap, flexible manufacturing methods combined with the increased efficiency of the panels could mean wider applications than just rooftops and solar farms. We're talking potentials for solar walls and possibly even solar cars. We did a whole video on the potential for solar on vehicles, which you can check out here. So great, cleaner, cheaper, more efficient solar panels. Sounds a little too good to be true, doesn't it? Well, if you've watched our videos before, you know that every new thing in development comes with a trade-off, and perovskite solar panels are no exception. Roadblock number one, and this one's kind of a biggie. When it comes to durability, perovskite panels come nowhere close to silicon panels. Many perovskite solutions dissolve in water, and ironically, they don't stand up very well to high temperatures above 160 degrees Fahrenheit. Those high temperatures cause ions to move more rapidly, degrading the material's molecular structure over time. The irony, of course, is that these panels are meant to sit in direct sunlight all day. Laboratory experiments have shown that perovskite panels lasted about 4,000 hours, roughly 2 years at 5 hours of peak sunlight per day. Yikes, my first 5 solar panels were installed in 2011, and after 10 years, they're still going strong. I did a whole video on my experience 10 years later, which you can check out here. These results were based on early prototypes, and researchers believe they are closer to developing more stable panels utilizing alternative materials and protective layers. Still,
it's likely that first generation perovskite panels may only last around 15 years. For commercial grid level applications, panels typically need to last for a minimum of 20 years, preferably 30 or more. Roadblock number two, the panels might be toxic. Right now, the most efficient perovskite panels incorporate lead, which is not great for the environment or public health. Researchers have experimented with other materials, but these materials also impact efficiency. Right now, the best bet is halide perovskites, which have an efficiency of around 25%. Some workarounds, again, may involve encasing the panels in glass or plastic, which could help both contain the lead while also protecting the cells themselves. In 2013, researchers discovered a means to manufacture perovskite panels using inkjet printers. This test showed promising results for producing leak-free lead panels. The lead is not a major concern, but it is something researchers are going to have to improve. As of right now, Oxford PV expects to have a tandem perovskite silicon panel on the market by 2022, making it the first company to do so. But let us know what you think. Are perovskite panels the way forward for solar power, or are they just another empty promise? Sound off in the comments below. All right, so that is a look at perovskite solar panels. As you mentioned, they're way thinner than silicon panels, which is really advantageous. There's a potential to save a ton of money and materials and have better efficiency. So a win-win-win all around. But we need to harden it and make them last longer. The really cool thing is we could potentially look at other places where we currently don't think about solar today, like on vehicles or glass buildings. We've got some videos planned, so definitely subscribe and stay tuned for all of that. All right, a huge thank you to all of you for watching. And if you want to be a rock star supporter of this show, please consider becoming a member of our YouTube channel membership or a patron on Patreon. We call you guys the 2-Bit Tribe. Come join us on Discord where we can chat about future video scripts. Maybe you can talk about ideas that you have, and we can just generally hang out and you'd be supporting the show. Also, take a look around. I bet you there's some other videos that you're going to love. I'm Ricky with Two Bit da Vinci, and just remember, the future is gonna be awesome.